Counting.
All systems green.
Ready to go, Sir Gilbert.
Wish her luck.
This is it. Goodbye, Kingfisher. Best of luck.
Thank you.
Lift off.
We have lift off, gentlemen.
He wanted to go down.
Promise me one thing, Sir Hubert. If they fail, for whatever the reason, promise me I go on the next probe.
It must not fail. We can't afford another failure.
A week later, Digby was serving up my breakfast.
Shall I turn the ticker news off, sir? Breakfast is ready.
Good chap. Don't tell me. Bacon, eggs, hot toast.
Eh, no, but them vitamin blocks again. Queer doing it, sir. Vitamin blocks. I tell you, my Auntie Anastasia has had 40 fits of...
She'll be having them too, Digby.
Nay, sir, not up in Lancashire. Still a few pigs hidden in the back, no doubt, and a few hens left a-laying. Hey, I could ask her to send a dozen if...
No, thank you, Digby. I'd rather not know about your formidable aunt's black market activities.
Just thought I'd happen to cheer you up, sir. You've had a face like Fortum since Kingfisher left. No one's been to Venus before, have they, sir?
Digby!
Colonel Dare's residence.
Go there to report to headquarters immediately.
My cap, Digby! Hurry, man, get the jeep jet!
I don't know what the hurry is, I'm sure.
At any moment, Kingfisher will be arriving at the point where the other ships disappear, Digby. So step on it!
Kingfisher bearing ZN76AL34.
Cross-bearing from Moonfix XC51.
We had our first view of the Kingfisher from the external orbiting cameras.
Activated.
She looked in good shape.
Give me voice contact with Captain Crane.
I can hear him, but we can't seem to get through to him, sir.
Switch from headphone to speaker contact. This is the critical time.
We have a firm bearing, Captain Crane.
Good. 3 hours, perhaps, sir.
What the?
Impulse cylinders, sir. Impulse cylinders. I have no power. My controls are dead, sir.
All crew, hear this, hear this. Impulse cylinders gone. Stop jets. Seal 5, 7 and 8 bulkheads. Break out emergency oxygen and pressure suits.
Star, sir! Star!
Ironical, it seems to me, sir.
Ready, Digby? Step on it down.
Sir.
Damn hastily, get waiting.
A world government ends wars, doctors get all the diseases taped, poverty's more or less gone, everything in the garden's lovely, except there's nought to eat in it.
That's bound to happen. Population doubles and redoubles, takes up farming land, what's left has been exhausted by bad farming, can't grow enough food, and so, chaos. That's why Venus was so important, possible farming land.
I think I know what happened to Kingfisher, sir.
Huh?
This new class of ship works off impulse wave engines. These waves, bounced off the moon, are picked up by the in-flight airships. Picked up by the cylinders. Say a shield were erected to prevent those rays getting to the ship.
Well, they wouldn't have a chance. But who? How? Where?
Don't know until we go and see. Do I, Sir Hubert?
Go, Dan.
Old-fashioned rocket ships. Rockets went out with the Ark, Sir Hubert. Dreadful things.
Build one, soonest, understand? And 3 2-man shuttles to Colonel Dare's design.
It's important it has no impulse methodology.
No impulse? Mad, Colonel.
Rebuild one of the early models.
Down here at Space HQ, there is a scene of frantic activity as Colonel Dare supervises the rebuilding of a spaceship that seems to have come from the old museum in London. This may be the last hope for the world.
There have been riots in Jakarta and on the western seaboard of America. A news blackout...
We are running out of time.
She's ready for testing. 3 months from start to finish. I hear you got a new crew joint.
Is there no way to keep a secret here?
Not about the Ranger. No, sir.
She is a beauty. A beauty, Sir Hubert.
I trained on one of these shuttles, oh, way back. You want to give the personal rocket vehicle a trial run? I cleared it with control.
Ignition. Adjust the throttle. And away we go.
Tally-ho!
Well, I'll be gall darned if I ever saw anything like that outside a Houston museum. Man, amazing.
I've never in my life to think men risk their lives in such bone shakers.
Colonel Dare.
That's right. He around? He must be laughing fit to bust seeing that old crate doing a fly past.
Up in your mind. You'll see you on the landing area.
Jumping jets! That crate landed!
I have a nasty feeling, my friend. You know this day?
Flown with him. Hell of a pilot. Hell of a good pilot.
Afternoon, gentlemen.
Dan! What are you doing in that thing?
Flying it, Hank.
I have a very nasty feeling.
What gives, Dan? Venus? No chance. Off your little trolleys, boys. A suicide ride. I promised my little wife no trouble. No adventures, no risk, no insurance.
Your wife?
Second wife. You'd like her, Dan. Hold on, I got a couple of 3Ds.
I have more important things to think about, Hank, than wives. You coming to Venus or not?
Of course he will come. We are honored.
Thank you, Pierre. Hank?
She'll never forgive you. Okay.
Professor Peabody is usually on time, I understand.
Some bumbling old daughter. Remember that trip we did to Alpha Megasauri, Dan, when we took that prof along? He was a damn nuisance.
Well, I'm assured by personnel that the professor comes with the highest of recommendations.
Sir Hubert, Colonel Dare. Professor Peabody reporting rather late. Sorry. Had to hand over a rather complex experiment on atmospheric pollution and pollen counts to an assistant.
I say.
Gentlemen, you want a geologist, botanist, and agriculturalist. I am all those. You wish to check my credentials?
No. Merci, mademoiselle. It is that we are discussing a dangerous, near enough suicidal flight, and we had no thoughts of women on such a mission. We are sure you are a good scientist.
Women in space? Damn it all. The PM's private line.
I am also a qualified space pilot.
What do you do in your spare time, Prof?
I'm a world expert on orchids.
Oh. Prime Minister, Professor Peabody has just arrived. We... an order? From the cabinet? Yes, of course, sir. Women. Bah.
A week later, we were ready to leave for the planet Venus.
Systems locked.
Hank, okay?
7, 4... 3...
Recording.
0 on holding.
Places for takeoff. Places for takeoff. Places for takeoff.
Check all systems.
All off hold.
All systems go.
Retroactors in place.
7, 4, activated.
Good luck.
We left planet Earth on the 15th of July, and 3 weeks later were approaching what had become known as the graveyard. We were kitted up in our space exploration suits and ready to get away from the orbiting mothercraft in the space shuttles.
Look all right, do I, sir?
That parachute doesn't do much for your figure, Dig, but you'll do.
Are you sure you can handle the shuttle, Mr.?
No, sir. Rocket Shuttle 4, Peabody and Sir Hubert, ready.
Thank you, Professor.
Number 3, Lafayette and Hogan. Ready to go.
Thank you, Pierre. Ranger, we're leaving you now. Good luck, everyone.
Vaya que thump.
Near the danger zone now, Dick. 3 and 4, this is your leader.
We're going in now.
The radio, sir. Blow it up.
I should have remembered. The radio works on impulse waves. We can't even warn the others.
There's fire, sir. And the plates all down one side are buckled and strained.
Hold on, Dick. Hold on.
Sir, atmosphere warning. We've hit the air around Venus, sir.
Yippee, we can bail out of the old Keitel hole together while we slow down.
Ready to abandon ship. Right, sir. Got your PD pistol, sir. No time to pack anything else, sir.
Here goes. Jump, TP.
Grand. Venus at last. No ship, no radio, no food, no doubt. Why I ever joined the space fleet, I'll never know.
I lost sight of Digby as he drifted towards the craggy mountains to the west. I was coming in too fast, thinner atmosphere. Directly below was a lake.
Get rid of the chute! Quick, quick! Here we go!
Water. Felt like water. Looked like... purple soup. A fish, so it sustained life. That was something.
Oh, will you look at trouble? No way to welcome guests, you refugee from Loch Ness. I'll have to put you to sleep, old friend. Thank heaven Dick remembered the paralyzing pistol. Now, get ashore and sort out the mess.
Sir! Are you all right, sir?
Fine, Dick. How about you?
Oh, fair to middling, sir. Bit of a nasty go out there, sir. I don't see any bus stops, sir. No snack bars, for that matter. Nor anywhere.
What next? Is that what you mean?
In a word, sir, yes.
We had an RV planned if one of the other ships got through.
Oh, I see, sir. Great, sir. And how do we get to this RV?
The coordinates are locked into the infrared compass, all ready to go. All we have to do is follow the bearings.
Oh, across the lake? Is that all, sir?
Crossing the lake was easy.
We built a small raft, set up a chute, a sail, and as the prevailing wind seemed to be in our favour, it took little time to cross the purple lake.
Not a sign of our antediluvian, our old friend neither. Time for should die.
Trust you, Dig, a completely unexplored planet, and what do you do? Go to sleep.
I'm conserving energy, as it happens.
Eventually we arrived on the far side of the lake.
Shanks' pony now, Dig.
I don't like the look of this gully, sir. No, them boulders up there. Look out, sir! You think we want it here, sir?
Just keep an eye open.
Yes, sir.
We climbed through the rocks and away from the lake until...
Look at that, sir. It's carved, sir. A huge pillar. Never natural light, Colonel. And look, there's a cave behind you, sir. Like it was a gateway or something.
We'll take a look, Dick. Careful now.
You ever get the feeling that you're being watched? Like eyes all over the...
Shush, Dick. Dig. The work of intelligent beings. You see, this one here looks very like a man, and this very much like ancient Egyptian art, Dig. Dig? Digby!
Don't look now, sir, but I think we've been followed by what looked like a bunch of overgrown blue bottles.
I'll check him out, sir.
Don't shoot, Dig. I'll talk to them.
Don't be daft, sir. Talk to a bunch of heathens. You'll be famous last words, sir. They won't even appreciate
it. Stop nattering.
Keep me covered. Oh, you murderous butcher. I'll get you for that. Here goes.
Stunned.
We looked over at the figures paralyzed by Digby. We walked out of the caves and saw across the valley a vast transporter.
Wow! Like Blackpool, South Shore when I was a kiddie.
Look out, Digby, behind you on the left!
Oh, hey! Get off, you great blue horror! Get off! Sir!
Give up, Digby!
Don't fight me outnumbered!
We were marched across the valley to the flashing transporter.
They stuck us on top. It climbed to a great cliff and then turned on full power and headed straight for the purple lake.
What happens if the brakes fail, sir?
Hang on.
It had taken us hours to cross the lake. It took the Venusian machine less than 20 Earth minutes to speed over the surface. We arrived at a vast ramp leading to huge green and yellow pillars. Domes glinted under the watery light of the sun. The whole city, for it was a city, hummed. The blue men took us under guard into a huge inner chamber and ripped our breathing helmets from our heads.
No! We can't breathe!
By X, sir! We can, sir! It's air, sir.
Tendon glotton, I agree.
Good, you're right, Digby. The air must have fooled our testers.
Colonel, sir. Am I seeing what I think I'm seeing?
We saw a tall figure that at first looked not unlike a man. But the face was that of a reptile. Green. The eyes cold as ice, black as a shark's and with as little feeling in them. The mouth tight, thin, cruel. Wonder if he knows Morse. I never took Venusian at school.
Colonel Dare. Spaceman Digby, I presume.
How on earth do you speak English?
We have studied the Earth for 26,000 years. Every dream child knows all its languages. We have humans to check with. The blue men came from Earth thousands of years ago. An experiment. Now, turn round. We have something to show you.
Behind us, on a large stand, was a three-dimensional screen. Held in the middle of the screen, Pierre's space shuttle, just on the edge of the danger zone.
Hank, let's hope we are right about the radio. You ready, my friend?
Go for it, Major.
Good luck and happy landings, Pierre. Well done.
We have a welcome for you. First, you can watch your friends die.
They won't die. They're not going to hit your ray shield.
They don't have to. They are heading for the Flamelands.
Flamelands?
Our planet is divided into two by a molten belt round the equator. For centuries, we have had little contact with the south. Your friends are heading for the molten belt.
I'm sorry. My fault, old friends.
Interesting. No fear. Yet you have not yet conquered pity. We waste time. You will be sent by electrosender to Mekonta, our capital city, for your special welcome.
Thank you.
nose up, Danny.
I had no wish to be a rib of beef.
Swing her up. Give her the gun, man. Wow. That was a narrow shave, friend.
On Venus, Digby and I were looking over the glass domes and walkways of the huge mechanical city of Maconte. Buzzing sky scooters, roadways and electrosender tubes crisscrossed the city.
My orders are to take you to the director of the Earth Research Center.
Orders? Whose orders?
You will go by flying chairs. These flying chairs are controlled by thought impulses. Hardly suitable for such puny brains as yours. I will direct all three. You will get on.
Quiet, Colonel. I never thought I'd see the day.
Ooh, oops. Look at this, sir. No arms, eh?
Hand me the helm. I'm in command here, Miss Peabody.
Switch the gyro stabilizer. Start the reactor jets.
You'll answer for this later, Miss Peabody.
The Earthmen, old director.
Good. Spectro analysis first. The experiments are ready.
Green auras, just string them along. See if we can make a peaceful arrangement to send food to Earth. We are official envoys. I demand to be taken to your chief officer, your president or prime minister.
You mean the supreme scientist, the illustrious first one of Venus, the Mecum of Meconta.
Right, the gaffer.
You insects. You would not even be allowed in the same building as that magnificent brain.
Master. A third rocket is about to land on the northern fringe of the Flame Lands.
We have no need of any more specimens. Fasten them to the slide and give the first injection.
One is a woman, oh master.
A woman? That will be interesting. We will watch them as they crash.
We can't pull out! I can't pull her out, Sir Human! I can't control!
I'm sorry I said some harsh things, Miss Peabody. You're a damn brave woman. Maybe we'll come through, and if we don't, we gave it our best shot. Hold tight!
Sir Hubert! Sir Hubert!
Are you all right, Miss Peabody?
We're dented, but still airtight, I think. Is your observation hatch still clear?
Yes, we seem to be in a sort of...
Look, Sir Hubert, 10 degrees starboard. What is that?
It looks like glass, molten glass.
It seems to be moving.
It is moving. I don't like the look of it. It's moving towards us.
Why, sir, will you look at that? It's a moving mountain. It's coming closer to them.
Don't let them see your concern, Digby. These green-faced so-and-sos will love that.
Love, Colonel? Love? It is something we do not understand. Is it pity that we are registering on your thought patterns, or fear?
What are you doing, Sir Hubert?
Fasten your helmet, Mr. Peabody. I'm going out to recce. Wait here for me.
I'm coming with you.
You will not leave the ship. That's an order, Mr. Peabody.
Good luck, sir.
Chin up, eh? That's it. Now then, I'll check the outer structure. Fins retracted and undamaged. Shield shows signs of overheat on entry.
Check the jets, Sir Hubert. I have emergency state on each of my control panels.
It's damn hot out here. Right, jets. Both clogged. It's as if they've been sealed. It's sort of hardened plastic. Almost glass.
Could we use the jets to get clear?
Miss Peabody, if we use the jets, the whole ship would explode. Hold on. Oh, my God. Oh, no.
Sir Hubert!
We are registering something here.
Anger. You could stop this. You could help them. Save them.
Why? I do not understand.
They are at great risk. They could die.
We shall learn much if we let them die. They have no hope of surviving.
If I could get out of this chair, I'd show you what we think of that where I come from. There's a lady there in danger.
I'm sinking, Miss Peabody. I'm sinking into... Miss Peabody, help me! Help me!
Hold on, sir! Catch this rope. It's tied off to the hatch frame. Haul yourself up, sir. Pull!
Thank you, Miss Peabody. Well done. Now we have little to it. If we try to lift off, we will blow ourselves to bits. If we stay, we will either suffocate as we sink or roast from the heat.
Oh, don't look now, sir, but that glass mountain is moving towards us.
What?
You were supposed to have the good ideas, sir.
How can I? They have no understanding of pity. To them, it's just another experiment.
How right you are, Colonel. We could use two for dissection if we had them all. Dissection? Very well. Colonel, you're anxious to rescue them. Do it, and we will be able to advance our knowledge even more. Come along, Colonel. You have little time.
We can't do it, sir. If we rescue the Prof and Sir Hubert, we take them out of the frying pan into the fire, so to speak.
We can't let them fry, Digby.
You will go by telesender, Colonel.
Don't get me wires crossed.
We have arrived, Colonel.
Digby, why are you standing on your head? Come out of there and sort yourself out, man.
Technical hitches do occur from time to time.
But why is it always to me?
We were taken to a gallery of space vehicles and land transporters.
The Flight Museum, Colonel.
Are they all in flying condition?
Intergalactic flying machines are kept in new condition by the airlock.
Hey, up, sir. How about that? It's a beauty. A helicopter, sir. Perfect.
It might do the trick, Dick.
Jet-propelled copter. Obsolete for 1,000 years.
We took it. They fitted fluorine sprays to neutralize the silicon mountain. Digby clambered aboard first, and we had our next surprise.
Who the old lad are you when you're at home?
I am Sonda, your pilot. Try no silly tricks. We are ready to go. Stand by.
We headed due south out of the huge hangar, up out of a volcanic crater and fast towards the flame lines, a race against time.
Professor, have you ever seen anything, heard of anything like this glass mountain?
Never, Sir Hubert. Anything in its way just gets sucked under. Still, while there's life, there's hope.
You're a very brave woman.
Sir Hubert.
Just watch how he handles the ship. I'll try and make friends.
Fat chance, sir. My Auntie Anastasia would have had a word for him, sir. Uppity, sir. Uppity.
I can try. We haven't been properly introduced yet.
I know who you are, Colonel. I told you my name is Sonda, and you will obey my orders. I see you are extending your hand to me. We have always thought shaking hands illogical.
An old custom, a friendly gesture.
Usually employed by businessmen and politicians when they are about to cheat one another. Sit down, Colonel Dare.
Any luck, sir?
He's about as friendly as a frisky stoat.
We are approaching the silicon mass now.
Sir, look, sir. Where that outsized mintumbug's leaking over the sand, sir. Poking out, sir. It's the ship.
The silicon will cover them in the next few minutes. You have little time to get them.
You seem concerned all of a sudden.
Our experimenter wants to use them. My orders are to bring them back. Yours to obey me. We will see what our fluorine spray guns can do.
We looped round the edge of the advancing mass, and Sondar hit the firing button. The fluorine seemed to fill the charged atmosphere below with a fine mist and release the death grip of the silicon mass. Below us, waving up from the rocket, were...
It's them! They're alive! We have done it, Digby! Damn good show!
Aye, up and it is. Just one thing, Colonel Dacey. They're on a sinking rocket, surrounded by some hot liquid stuff, and we're up here!
Rope ladder. Part of the kit. I checked before we left. All we have to do is to pay it out for them.
We winched down the ladder, and Sonder held the copter steady as a rock as the Professor and Sir Hubert clambered on board.
Wonderful.
Where the dickens?
You can open your helmets. Everything's laid on, including air. Welcome aboard.
Thank you, Colonel. Just in time.
Oh, golly, Dig. You've no idea how glad I am to see your happy, smiling face.
Well, it's not exactly Freedom Hall, as you might say, miss.
Oh, why?
You might even say you're out of the fire and into the frying pan, in a manner of speaking.
What are you talking about?
Him, sir, at the controls. And his little friends back home, sir.
Call themselves trees.
What did you mean about the frying pan?
Not the sort of tactile, Digby. His friends, sir, boffins, run wild. Quite inhuman. They have no emotions at all.
Then are we
prisoners, sir? Just for the moment. At least the trees think so.
So what do we do about it?
Now you and Miss Peabody are here as reinforcements, I'm going to take executive action.
Do nothing so foolish. Your intentions are quite clear to me. You are quite powerless. Quite, quite powerless.
I don't think so, Chum. I'm sorry about this.
Well done, sir. Here, down we go. Ladies on knees. Kitchenware.
Trolls, kick me. Give Sir Hubert a hand and drag our tree friend out of the way.
Right, sir.
Well, let's get out of here fast. How is he?
Coming round, I think.
I'd like a crack at him, sir.
Sorry, Dick. You take over the controls while I keep an eye on him.
Right, sir.
And change course, old boy. We're probably flying on an automatic radar beam controlled by the trees in Makata.
Aye, aye, sir. Heading now due south. The wind's getting up, sir.
Dirty weather. Change bearing due west.
Will do, sir.
It's a twister, Dan. A huge tornado course on the starboard bow.
Ahead, Dan. Another tornado. It's moving across us. It's heading us on.
West, Dick.
I can't, sir. There's another twister there.
We're being shepherded like sheep.
Well, they're all round us. We can't take this old bucket into any of those winds. They're running at hundreds of miles an hour.
Clear to the north. Tree in handiwork or I'm a Dutchman.
So, we turn north or make a dash for it?
Your tree friend's away, Dan. Ask him which we should do.
Sonder, can you hear me?
Yes, I hear you. You want to know which way to head?
Yes.
They want us back at headquarters for experiments.
Us? You as well?
I was afraid when the ship was in danger. I displayed emotion. Unscientific. They will want to trace my fall.
We're in the same boat.
That does not matter. I will be proud to serve Treen Research.
I'll give the research program a miss, I think. Head due south, Dick. Into the tornado barrier.
Here we go! We're being sucked in, sir. I can't hold her. I can't. We're going down. I'm gone.
Everyone all right?
These trees we've landed in.
See nothing like them, not even in the Congo Delta project. Quite outside my experience. Colonel Dare, I'm going outside.
Oh, be careful, Miss Peabody.
I'll be fine. Jungles are nothing to worry about. Branches are like rubber. Soft. Fantastically strong.
Oh, it's like landing on matches. We were very lucky. Sir Hubert, Prof, have you any weapons with you?
We have our paralyzing pistols, that's all.
Right. Mm. Dig, got the infrared compass?
Yes, sir.
We needed to make the rendezvous with Hank and Pierre.
If they're still alive.
If they manage to crash outside the flame belt, they will be.
Oh, Bayek! Oh, Thump!
We slashed and struggled our way through the dense jungle away from our crashed copter. We had to avoid the Treen guards who would be after us and try to make contact with Hank and Pierre. If they had survived.
It's hopeless, Professor. We're never going to get through.
Wait.
What is it?
Shush, listen. To the right. It's a river. If we head for it, we may find it easier going.
Follow me.
Sovereign snakes!
Quick, sir, you want a pistol, hurry!
Over here, under this fallen tree. All right, Sondar, you can come out now. It's safe.
Oh, frightened again, were you? Bit of a washout for a tree, you.
But, oopsie-daisy!
Understand why you save me. We do not understand unscientific actions.
Sondar, you may have forgotten it on Venus, but there are other things in life besides applied science, and we may need your help. We must get to the professor's river and across it if we can. So, come on, hurry.
Sir, look, sir.
What the?
I've heard of Niagara. Well, this is burning.
Stop chatting and get on. We have to climb those falls, all right?
Aye, sir. No time like the present. Might as well get going. Violet's like, Colonel. I could do your tea break.
Come on, Dig. A bit more effort will take us to the top.
Are we nearly there, Dan?
Near enough. The old boy was feeling his age, and Dig is no greyhound. If only I knew where the trees were.
The zombies are getting closer.
Hurry, Dig! So, Hubert, you're right.
Yeah, don't worry about me.
We reached the top of the falls and had time to see below us a vast open stretch of pale green water, an inland sea. And then...
Dan, behind you!
Jumping jets!
Blimey, dozens of them! Green so-and-sos!
Straight at them, gang!
Come on, the fleet!
The trees released a song from its leash and faced the black one.
The professor, out of my firing line! Dan! Oh, my hat! Dan, get back to the edge! Dan!
All over them. The trees cocooned us all in eggs of clear plastic and prepared to take us away.
It is unfortunate we lost Colonel Dare, but he will never return. Take them.
You couldn't help it, sir. Dan would feel more pain. I wish I could say the same for our prospects.
Stick by the professor.
You are now ready to help our scientists. Old Earth custom. Ladies first.
I'm not afraid of you.
I do not understand. Afraid?
Oh!
The disintegron is the only way of cutting this plastic. You will not try to escape again. In here.
We demand to be treated under the rules of the Geneva Convention.
There is no convention here, Sir Hubert.
Forget it, Sir Hubert. That was based on care and concern. These trees neither know nor care.
I understand you are trying to insult me. It will not work. You should be honored to be going to the presence of the Mekon himself.
Honored? Why?
He may have you dissected, oh fat one. The others will be tested, investigated, maybe laser operated. For
good at science.
Dissected? That's what they do to coconuts.
No, Dig. Desiccated is coconuts.
Your foolish colleague, Colonel Dare, is now dead. You have no leader. You are entirely in my power. Here is a Tele-Zero beam transmitter, at present focused on a full-sized replica of an Earth city. It has been built on Venus for testing purposes. Watch that screen. See the fate of your miserable planet and its pathetic peoples. Watch.
There's nothing. Nothing left of the place.
Nothing. Dust.
People, whole populations will
die.
What's the use? No train can go there after such a...
Show them. I see. Understand. Go.
I tell you something for nothing. They'll be wild about him in Wigan.
Very clever indeed.
Naturally. Now, we are going to use you. You will be useful in the final stages before we invade planet Earth.
Invade?
We need to know the extreme limits of human resistance. Then, we shall extract your brains for further study.
Under the swirling waters of the falls, I was still able to think, but not able to move my body. The waters churned and whirled and finally threw me into a long tunnel. I had to break surface or I would drown. Thank heavens I can move again. I crawled onto the ledge away from the frightful dark water and towards the light. I checked my compass and knew that without a doubt, I had been swept under the flame belt that cuts Venus in half. The Southlands were bathed in glorious sunlight. Huge red and gold flowers, outcrops of purple grass lay over the rich dark earth. I drank from a clear water stream, washed and set off across the wide open countryside. Praying the natives were friendly. I found myself in the main square of a vast city, a humming, vibrating city, without a single person to be seen. I climbed to the top of a tall stone building. Looking out, I could see far away what looked like irrigation ditches and fields. There had to be people, inhabitants somewhere. Or why bother to irrigate fields and grow crops? I headed for the open country. A harvester baled the crop automatically and tipped it onto a series of automated moving platforms which headed away into the distance.
Nothing to lose. Go for a hayride, Dan Dare. Ah. Two hay bales, and that's as good as any bed. Right then. Ooh. Call me with a nice cup of tea at 10, Stuart.
The self-propelled trucks carried me across the hills and valleys of southern Venus, over bridges and through tunnels, humming along with its load of farm produce. I went to sleep.
and nearly died as a result. At its destination, a metal-toothed grab loomed over the bales of hay.
What the door? That was a narrow squeak.
Hi, Earthman.
Who the devil... You speak English?
We have two other Earthmen in our house.
What?
You won't tell my father I was at the transporter junction. He says it could be dangerous.
He's right. Look, I need to meet these other Earthmen.
I can take you. Come with me.
Frank, Pierre.
Mon brave, mon colonel, madame.
Wonderful.
Incroyable, mon vieux.
Where are the others? How did you get here?
We thought you were dead. What happened?
I told them all I could. They introduced me to Volstar. He was a leader amongst these trusting and generous people called Therons.
We had despaired of you and your friends, knowing that you had landed in the north among Treens. We have not been in contact with the Treens for centuries. The Flame Belt has kept us apart. We are worried to find you have managed to pass through the Flame Belt. Our defenses against the Treens will not stand up to their sophisticated weapons.
I didn't come through the Flame Belt, Volstar.
Then
I came under it.
Howling hyenas. Under? How?
I was carried by a subterranean river.
It is very important that you meet with our leaders.
As soon as possible.
I understand the situation on your home planet is desperate, Colonel Dare.
We need help. We need space to grow food for Earth. Here, perhaps.
That will be for our parliament to decide. You will be seeing our president, of course.
We must hurry. I have two urgent tasks. Fix up a supply of food for Earth and rescue my friends from the Comte.
Three, Colonel. We have heard via our radio satellites that the Mekon plans to destroy Earth.
Certainly.
Someone has to get back to your mother ship to warn your planet.
Your shuttle rocket, Pierre?
We'll be ready in a few days.
These guys may have given up living in cities or being ruled by machines, but they sure know their way around with a monkey wrench.
Volstar, I must talk to your president now.
Since we gave up cities as unsuitable for man to live in, we have houses that will move where we want them to. It's more convenient. At the moment, we are traveling at around 800 of your Earth miles an hour. The air bubble that surrounds us ensures no discomfort.
And while we traveled, Volstar told me something of the tragedy of Venus, of Earth, and of Atlantis. He told of the Theron attempts to pacify the Treen reptiles beyond the Flame Belt. When the gentle Therons realized that all the Treens cared for was power and science, they left them to their fate. The Therons explored space, found planet Earth, and discovered a landlocked valley, the center of Earth's civilization, Atlantis. Tragically, the Treens followed them. And systematically transship the Atlanteans back to Venus, where their descendants have been slaves ever since. The remaining Atlanteans, blaming the Therons, sabotaged their remaining spaceships. They smashed the housing over the atomic reactor engines. The result was catastrophe. The end wall of the valley collapsed as the Atlantic Ocean engulfed Atlantis, destroyed a civilization, and created the Mediterranean.
A people destroyed, save for the sad prisoners of the Treens whose descendants are the blue slaves of Maconta.
In the beautiful, tree-filled courtyard of the Theron's president's house, I tried to persuade the old man to help me go back into the north, to rescue Digby and the other crew members.
Naturally, we grieve for your friends, but there is little we can do to help.
I can't just sit and grieve. These people rely on me.
You cannot pass through the barrier erected by the Treens over the Flameland.
And you'll do nothing.
Hey, come on, man. Don't get too heavy.
We have achieved the perfect life here. Happiness and peace for our children. We mean to keep it.
And the rest can go hang. The Treens are planning to attack Earth, and you just sit back and enjoy your music. Great. Pity is fine. Grief, too. But if you let the Treens commit crimes you are able to stop, then they become your crimes, too. You sit here and read poetry and smell flowers while our Earth children are starving to death. You would sit here listening to music and talking to your wives while our wives are being butchered by Treens. Some civilization you have.
Dad, cool it.
President Kalon, I apologize.
No. I am shamed by what you say, Colonel. We will do all we can to help. Are you sure you can do it alone, Colonel?
I can if I can go back disguised as an Atlantean.
So what are these Atlanteans like, man?
I'll try and describe.
No, there's no need. We can make a tridermen with your help, Colonel, with this telepathy helmet.
This what?
If you will put this helmet on, Colonel Dare, and bring into your mind your memory of one Atlantean...
Mm-hmm. Fine. Go ahead.
No, you go ahead. Just concentrate. And remember.
Look! In the corner!
Look at that! A blue man with a... He's got a gun!
It's all right, Hank. It's just a part of the Colonel's imagination. An Atlantean soldier. Thank you, Colonel Bear.
Tout à l'heure! It has just melted away! And a bulge on the forehead!
We can use that bulge to solve a problem. We have a scientist standing by to make necessary changes. If you have the courage, Colonel Dare.
Try me.
Under the lamps, Colonel, it is here we will make the cosmetic changes. This wig has a large bulge at the front that enables you to speak and understand the Atlantean language. The headphones, receiver, and unscrambler are built into the bulge along the hairline. Try it on.
Oh, very well.
This is great.
Yes, I think this wig is probably terrible and tricky juggling, God.
Fantastic! Affreux, mes braves! He is a blue man. He speaks their language and he looks formidable.
Electronic navigator. Radar net for cavern navigation, rebreathing gear, autopilot. Queries?
How long can it stay under?
10 Earth hours. Its range will take you well clear of the flame belt. All checks are now completed.
Good. Is the slipway clear?
All clear and ready to go, Colonel Dare.
Au revoir, mon brave.
See you all in Piccadilly.
Good luck!
Just heard that your shuttle is repaired and ready for firing.
Great! We need to make visual contact with Ranger. Tout suite, as we say.
There has been a homing device fitted. It will bring you safely back here if you cannot contact your mothership for any reason.
Motors, go. Seals, go.
Retrieve activate.
Go.
Comms internal systems, go.
Okay, man. Let's burn some juice.
Rocket takeoff from southern hemisphere. Tracking devices activated.
Check all screens.
Inform the Mekon.
Inform the Mekon.
Inform the Mekon.
Inform the Mekon.
And
continue tracking the rocket. Course takes it over flame belt and on a northern orbit. Dispatch space interceptors. It's an Earth craft. Destroy it. It must never reach Earth. Destroy it.
Ranger, this is Shuttle 3. Do you hear us? Over.
Hal and Harry, where the blue blazes did that come from? Three of them, Pierre. All around us.
We have no chance.
Climb, Pierre, climb. That one's got us lined up.
Hey, we are gone, my friend. I can't avoid. I am jammed. Controls are jammed.
The Terrans have put a shield around us. Must have.
Zap the homing switch, Pierre, and let's get out of here.
The last one's heading for home.
When that ship returns, execute the pilot. I said no Earth rocket was to escape. This is aggression. There is no truce with the Therons. We are at war.
Right then, George, I hope you've got your master's ticket. We're on our own.
Ready?
What?
Ready.
Oh, right. Now, find the forward scope, check out the channels, and then talk course changes into the auto. George, are you still there? I'm a bit confused.
Yes. Well, channels and course already sorted. Radar operative. Auto changes locked.
Fine. Level off in center of stream and go due north against the current. Full speed ahead.
Now under flame belt. 200 miles from estimated discharge point.
Thanks, George. Check the forward screen. A huge shoal of fish, the 8 to 10 pounders. They'd feed a few thousand back on Earth.
Approaching a mass. Living. Across whole channel. Orders, please.
George,
Orders, please. Mass appears to be animal of some sort. Orders, please.
It's a huge squid.
Orders, please.
We're heading straight for it.
Orders, please.
Increase speed.
Agreed. We have armaments. To your left. Red button. Now. Fire now. Fire now. Fire now. All clear. Reducing speed to safety level through debris. Stay on auto.
Hours later, we emerged from the tunnel.
Now hear this. Now hear this.
Steady, George. Up periscope. Nightfall, as per schedule.
Of course.
We have a problem. George! Waterfall dead ahead!
All right, don't panic. No problem. Fasten safety harness. Activate all green modules.
Huh? What on earth?
Joystick now activated. Press light button on top center to avoid all.
Button pressed! Oh, wow! You chaps think of everything! Searchlights! Clash dive, George! George, dive! Dive! Dive!
Meanwhile, in Maconta, Dig and Co. were suffering terrifying endurance tests.
I've told you. I was born in Wigan, and I know folk there will not stop fighting because you turn up.
Why? If they know we can kill them all, why not just give in?
You'll not understand, son. Right.
You can't frighten me with dentist pills or whatever that is. The genetic pool is such that man seems to have created many differing versions of himself. You teens are only clones of each other, true?
That is more efficient.
Maybe, but for a scientist, random ideas can sometimes lead to exciting results. You understand?
I must ask the Mekon to talk with you. I do not understand.
You can question me till you're blue in the face. It doesn't change the fact that the Earth will go on struggling to survive whatever you may think. Free and not as slaves.
Meanwhile, under the water, I left the craft on the floor of the lake and, using my personal rebreather, made my way to the surface. Once out of the water and away from the watering holes of the huge reptiles that lived in the wilds of the Treen Hemisphere, I dumped the underwater kit, changed into the blue man's costume, put on the translator wig, and, using an old map provided by one of the oldest Therons, headed towards the Atlantean reservation. Down below me in the dark night lay the sparkling lights of a small Atlantine village.
Here we go. I'll switch on the translator and see if I can get by as an Atlantine serf.
I crept closer to the center of the village. An angry meeting was going on. Amazingly, I could understand everything the Blue Atlanteans were saying. The younger men were facing what was clearly the village council. One of the young men was speaking, angrily.
We know Urtag, our headman, is wise and careful, but the time has come when wisdom's not enough. He grows old and his blood grows thin. This is the time for action. They're taking all our young men for the army, and we know who'll be the first to die. Die for treason!
No!
We have no quarrel with the men beyond the flameland! If we must die, let it be as free men, not as slaves for treason! Our faces be ground into the dust!
Listen to him. I beg you. Three times our fathers have revolted, and three times we have been defeated and punished. We can hold on to our dreams of freedom, but we must have patience. We have no weapons, no machines.
We'll take them.
Wait, my children, wait.
Give a brand from afar.
Come here. It is mine.
Spy!
I'm no spy.
Why did you not blow the horn by the sun god's gate to announce your arrival?
I'm sorry. I am a hunter from the other side.
Never. He's a
trained
spy. Trained spy.
Children, wait!
If he tells the Treens about this meeting, we're done for.
Bring him on the execution tree!
No one is lynching me! Take that! Come on, then. I don't want to fight you, but...
I lost my translator wig in the struggle. Suddenly, I could understand nothing. Then, they stood back from me, raised their arms, and began to cry out.
Stranger, forgive us. You are welcome here. We have things to show you. Things to explain. Come!
You see here an ancient hero, dead many centuries. He lived and died a free man. The Treens never caught him, and our legends promise that one day he will return to lead us to freedom. There is one thing that marks him out from us.
His forehead has no bulge, like mine.
Kargaz was his name, and you carry it now as well. He was old Earth stock, as you must be.
I am.
Tell me no more. For us, You are Kargaz. You will help us win our freedom.
And you can help me release my friends who are prisoners of the Mekon.
We will try.
The trains are coming!
They round us up like animals. Make us fight people we have no fight with.
It struck me that joining the Treen's army might speed up my getting to Mekonta. Meanwhile, in the Mekon's audience chamber...
Remove the shield over the flame belt.
Yes, Omega.
Send reconnaissance planes over Theron land.
Yes, Omega.
Make the reflective spacecraft ready for takeoff. Prepare for war.
Stormtroopers marched us Atlanteans to the nearest police post, and from there we were herded into electro senders. They transported us to Mekonta. We were taken to the barracks to be kitted out. An old sergeant major spotted me when I was first ready and waiting.
Hello, hello, hello! Who's this then? You there! Stand up when I talk to you, you horrible little man! Do you know who I am? I am the cohort Stapon in chief, and you horrible little... I know a reservation lad when I see one, and you are not one of them. Who are you?
I had no option. I briefly lifted the front of my helmet.
What? Well, Kargaz.
Will you help me?
To the last drop of my blood. I've prayed all my life that you turn up. Just give your orders.
Meanwhile, in the Mekon's audience chamber...
We have observed you Earthmen to be stronger than we thought.
Oh, Eck, I'd love one of Anti-Anastasia's aspirins now.
We have found a way to defeat your planet without giving ourselves too much trouble.
You are mistaken, sir.
Humans are emotional to the point of weakness. We have ways of playing on that. You will help us.
We will not.
Never.
I think you will.
Count me out, you stinking old toad.
Hear me. I, the greatest, the all-seeing and all-wise, know how to defeat these zeros. We will send a ship to Earth with pictures of the prisoners. As if injured on landing, but now being looked after. They will make a recording telling their fellow men how good and kind we have been. We will promise those fools on Earth food. But first we will tell them we have to build a transfer station on the moon. And then we will have our telezeros installed. And the Earth, with its great magnetic fields, its minerals and its industries, will be ours to pluck. Its population, our slaves. We will rule the universe.
You're barmy.
You will pose for some pictures. Record your messages. And then you will be spared to work in the mines at our North Pole.
I can smell rats in you that falls by. Green, nasty, and putrid.
Words, Digby, do not hurt me. Now, we will put Miss Peabody into the gas chamber.
What,
And you may watch her slow and excruciating death on the telescan. I'm sure you'll enjoy it.
You swine! Hold on a minute, sir. A message you said to home? Yes, I want to tell Auntie Anastasia how much I miss her.
Digby, I order you not to give it.
We don't have a chance, Sir Hubert. And Miss Peabody might be gassed.
Then he winked at me, old Dig. Something was going through his mind.
Left! 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 Halt! Position of first degree. Move. Good, good. Good. We'll make a soldier of you yet.
Father, I've found the Earth prisoners. They're done for, I'm afraid.
I will call you Dan, your Earth name. The Treens will have you locked up double quick if they hear the name Gargas. Now, if they take your people to the pole, as my son says they will, they'll never be got out of the mines, never. But the Treens will want an escort for them. On the double!
Now, fact one. You have recorded the message for your Earth parents?
Not my parents, Meekon. Me auntie. I've got it written down here.
Let me see.
I've done what I was asked.
I like the intimate touches. Enjoyed the layout in where?
Sunnymouth. Seaside place.
Yes, yes. Add his message to the photographs.
Yes, Meekon.
Commander, First Army, you are ready?
Yes, Meekon. As soon as I land on Earth with the messages, I will report back by teleview.
Good. You will be sent under guard to the North Polar Mines and live a few miserable years there. Never let it be said that the Meekon does not keep his word. Take these away.
Damn! Colonel, sir.
Escort, take them.
We're not moving.
Very well. You have disobeyed the Meekon. That is enough. I'll waste no more time. Kill them!
Ready, Bluebirds?
Now! One move! One move and I'll kill him! Run out, train guard! Lock him up! In that room at the end, if it is secure! There is no time for explanations! You know the way around this insect's fun palace. Get us out of here, quick!
This way!
Go right, Dan. And up the stairs.
We can't go up much further, Dan.
Wait, Dan, what's wrong?
Well, there's only this gallery.
Door 77A closed. Monitor them. They have the Meekon. The next Meekon is still a pupa. We cannot let him die. It will take 50 thanets before our next Meekon is prepared. Isolate them at the top of the building. Televiewers on all corridors.
Hey! Look at that!
Hey! Just a thing for an escape party. Flying chairs. A ferry bicycle park.
Can you work those things, Dagon?
Thought control. Too powerful. The Meekon could if he woke up. But he'd direct us straight to the nearest lockup.
Can you fly these bikes, Sonder?
I will do my best.
Well, no one will dare attack us while I have the Meekon under my arm.
Come on!
All aboard!
I have to have help. You must all concentrate. These work on powerful thought waves. I need help to deal with all these spikes. Are you ready?
Yes.
Remember, Dan, keep the Meekon asleep or his thought power will shatter my grip on the machines.
A pleasure.
You look sweet, sat on a seat of a bicycle made for two.
Hey.
They were coming at us mob-handed. A complete battle squadron.
Cease this foolishness. You are surrounded and have no chance of getting away.
You fly away, Sunshine. If you don't give us a clear sky, I'll snap this Wonder Boy's neck over my knee.
It's worked, Dan. They're steering off.
Sondar was magnificent. He managed to hold us on course to the space station and the waiting rocket ship. No one gave us any trouble there once I held up their Meekon by the scruff of his chicken neck. It was easy, and, like a fool, I lost the advantage because it had all been too simple. Hey, what the
heck? You see, Colonel, there are two can play the hostage game.
I can sling you off, you little pipsqueak.
Do that, and the bike will deliver you where I have preset it to go. My guards will kill you so exquisitely, and your friends will die too.
They could take the rocket.
They won't. They are humans, so loyal, pathetically sentimental,
they will try to rescue you.
I have a small surprise for you, Mekon. A present from the Therons. A demagnetizer. Can you swim?
You think I have time for foolish sports?
Too bad. I press the button on this and the bike will fall out of the sky and into the lake. It destroys the magnetic field. What's your brain going to do about that? Here goes.
You fool. Ah!
They picked up the little insect and then turned for me. It was time to use the Theron demagnetizer again. Sonda, you old beauty! I grabbed the trailing edge of the bike and Sonda steered it ashore.
Oh, well done, Sonda. Very well done, old chap. Now, come on, my party. They'll be after us double quick.
Sondar said he could pilot the Tele-Zero reflector ship. It was the Mekon's secret weapon against the Therons, and a major coup to capture one. Meanwhile, south of the flame belt...
President Kalon.
Any news of Dan?
Nothing. His submarine is still on the riverbed sending out transponder signals. No more.
You got any spare fighters, Mr. President?
I can spare none.
Oh.
None even to escort you all back to Earth. We have to try all our rays on the Treens. They have nothing as protection against them.
Mr. President, we have word that there is a Tele-Zero reflector ship in the Treen fleet. It can deflect all our weapons. If they use that against us...
Important screen 7, sir.
Yes?
A Tele-Zero reflector ship is preparing to leave Nakontus, sir.
We have to destroy it. At any cost.
Meanwhile, we were battened down in the Tele-Zero reflector ship on the launch gantry. The Mekon was throwing everything he could at us.
Cable systems in go condition.
Thank you, Sondar.
What on earth?
They're attacking the supports.
We have no time for checks. Button black code 1 on purple panel.
Check fired. The Mekon continued to pour fire into the space station below us, killing thousands of his own people without a thought. We were happily riding into danger as Sondar boosted speed and shifted our trajectory.
So the Tele-Zero beam is powerful?
Deadly. Its only weakness is that they need a platform in space from which to reflect it, as it only travels in straight lines. But the Tele-Zero ship, that, gentlemen, is probably indestructible. We are in great danger. Somehow, we must blast it out of the sky.
Fight us away, sir.
We began to prepare for the attack we knew would come from the Trees. They, after all, had the Tele-Zero weapons capable of doing the business.
Battle stations, everyone.
Best of luck. Do what you can, Sonda.
I will.
Here they come. Dream fighters, dead astern.
reporting to Fearon President. Treen fighters attacking Telezero ship.
Treen fighters?
Fighting their own people? Pull the other leg. Hey, hold on, no.
Here, my friend, are you thinking what I'm thinking?
Dan! Right!
Dan, Dan.
Got to be, don't you see? They are fighting to stop their ship leaving, and who would take it?
Dan, Dan.
Come on, man. Come and get it.
I'm running out of ammo.
Just take one out for me, Sir Hubert.
Taking rear section. No leaks. Small panel ripped and buckled. No protection there from Telezero rays. Evasive turn to right.
Look, there are planes. Different planes and cruising fast. What are they, Dan?
The armed squadron 4 approaching target.
You have to call them off, sir. For Pete's sake, call off your fighters.
I'll do better than that. Control to fighter wave 1. President Kalon speaking. Orders cancelled. Reflector ship believed carrying Earthman Dare. Engage and take out Treen fighters.
Orders received and understood.
Great stuff, Prezi, old boy.
I want to take a fighter. Go and bash a few noses.
Come with me in the command ship.
You beauties!
Is he devil waggling his wings at us? Keep your mind on the job, boy.
The best sight I've seen in a long time. Go for him, Theron!
Come on, you lord! Come on, you Theron!
Malfunctioning.
Don't worry about
it. Place. Circuit 10 in overdrive.
Commander, assist crippled Telezero ship. We will take our occupants on board. Theron fighter wave 6, take out any stragglers and then act as rearguard.
They're running! The trains are running!
Before it does them any good. Do it.
Where's the Daypon?
He stayed in the Telezero ship when we abandoned it.
He took over the controls from Sondar.
That is so.
But he was wounded, badly wounded.
Look, look on screen too.
What is he doing?
He's turning the reflector ship. He's realigning it. Oh, no, 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 he can't. Contact him. Make contact.
All contact cut.
He knows, as we do, that the Telezero ray comes from one source. And he is going to destroy it.
But he'll be such a nice old buffer.
Dapon pulled the reflector ship on course and threw the wrecked machine straight at the building housing the Telezero transmitters.
To the foot of
the end of the Telezero for some time.
And the end of a very gallant gentleman. Dapon's brave action meant that the Treens would be no threat for many years to come.
We Theorons owe you a deep debt, Colonel Dare. We understand that planet Earth has grave problems. We agree to help feed the people of the Earth on one condition.
You said nothing about conditions before, Mr. President.
We will work on transporting food from southern Venus to Earth, providing there is a guarantee from the people of Earth that they will promise to take better care of the resources they have left. Time could run out again if they do not. And even our supplies are finite. We will need that promise.
I think, Mr. President, that there will be no problem with that.
Then please join in the Theron feast we have prepared for you. No vitamin pills, Digby, I promise you.
Bayek, will you look at that spread, eh?
Gentlemen, I am sorry to say there is a problem. The Treens are reported to have sent a battle fleet on a heading 87 degrees by 52. Direction Earth.
The Treens' first warship and reconnaissance flight headed across space for Earth, while Theron experts struggled to get a ship ready to take us home. We were too late. Everyone wanted to believe the Treens.
This is the English section of the World News, broadcasting to you on the BBC. The Venusians, who call themselves Treens...
Reassuring messages recorded on Venus by the Ranger crew under Captain Dare have been brought by the Treens. The world president is speaking at this...
At this historic moment, signing a treaty with our friends from Venus, in which they agree to ferry food and material to Earth... as soon as they have set up a receiver station on the moon.
And we are broadcasting for the first time the message from Spaceman First Class Digby.
Hey, the Treens are a grand lot. We are in an oxygen room in a fine hospital looking out over a beach. It reminds me of our hotel room on that holiday we had in Sunnymouth, Aunt Anastasia. Do you remember?
What?
In May, wasn't it?
May?
That's it. May Day Sunnymouth.
What?
It is like Sunnymouth here.
Fiddlesticks! Bayek. That message from Digby in space. Poppycock. I want a word with the chief. Young man, I can have you out of your job in a time to say night. Now, jump to it, Sonny Jim, or else.
What the? Aircraftman Digby's auntie.
You the manager.
I am Colonel O'Reilly, Supreme Commander.
The message from my Albert was a fake, was a warning. The Treens, or whoever they are, are deceiving you.
Now, madam, I hardly think you can know.
I brought Albert Fitzwilliam Digby up from the age of five. He was only once in Sunnymouth, in October, not May. And he hates the place like poison. Have a newspaper cutting, we'll tell you why. Here.
Mistaken identity, Albert Fitzwilliam Digby of West Bank Wigan, released from custody, held for a week as man police have been searching for, suspect in the Hammersmith murder.
He was in prison, accused of murder all the time he was in Sunnymouth, wrongfully, and not May either. All wrong, a warning of some sort.
May? May Day, he said. May Day. May Day is the international call sign for emergency. Sunnymouth. Wrongfully imprisoned. You're right.
I know I'm right. Albert Fitzwilliam Digby is no fool. He knew I'd sort it out.
Get me the PM. And a detachment of the International SAS to be put on full alert.
This is Dan Dare calling Earth. This is Dare calling Earth. Are you receiving me? Over. Oh, you, Stig. We'll just have to try and speed this old ship up somehow.
No chance of that, sir.
Stand there.
What's that?
This is Earth.
Listen, what?
We have just eliminated the Treen menace.
Eh?
Thanks to you and your man, Digby.
Hey!
Congratulated on his warning. All a huge debt. Thank you.
Thank you. Over and out. Digby, we have done it.
Aye, good old Auntie Stacey.
Forget it. And the Theorons will help. Feed the Earth's great work.
I think we might say mission accomplished, sir. Goodbye, Mekon.
Hello, Earth. Oh,
I know what I fancy, sir.
I know too, Dick. Fish and chips and a nice long sleep.
We'll be right back.